students could get banned from classes.
At Bethune-Cookman University tonight, so students are going to have to prove that they're not infected with COVID.
Our accreditation has not been affected, and we will continue to correct those things that need to be done in order to make Bethune-Cookman University all that it's capable of becoming.
Creating a legacy will always create a conversation. In 1904, Mary McLeod Bethune founded Bethune-Cookman University. Mary McLeod Bethune had humble beginnings. She was born July 10, 1875, in Maysville, South Carolina. Both of her parents, Samuel and Patsy McLeod, were former slaves. She was the 15th out of her 17 siblings. She also was able to teach herself how to read and write, being the only child out of her 17 siblings to have an education. Only having $1.50 with a heart full of passion, Dr. Bethune famously started the Daytona Literary and Industrial Training Institute for Negro Girls on October 3, 1904. With the talent and tenacity God gave her, she even created materials for her students from her own hands. Pencils from charred wood, ink from elderberries, and mattresses from the most stuffed corn sacks. Her first students were five little girls and her five-year-old son, Albert Jr. In less than 2 years, the school grew to 250 students. Recognizing the health departures and lack of medical treatment available to African Americans in Daytona Beach, she also founded the Mary McLeod Hospital and Training School for Nurses, which at the time was the only school of its kind that served African American women on the East Coast. Daytona Normal would continue to increase in popularity and merge with the Cookman Institute of Jacksonville, Florida in 1923 and become Bethune-Cookman College. Tireless, talented, and committed to service, Dr. Bethune held leadership positions in several prominent organizations, even while also leading her school. In 1935, she founded the National Council of Negro Women, which would become a highly influential organization with a clear civil rights agenda. She was appointed by President Franklin D. Roosevelt to the National Youth Administration in 1936. By 1939, she was the organization's director of Negro Affairs, which oversaw the training of tens of thousands of black youth. She was the only female member of President Roosevelt's influential black cabinet. She leveraged her close friendship with First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt to lobby for interrogate the civilian pilot training program and to bring the program to the campuses of historically black colleges and universities, which led to graduating some of the first black pilots in the country. That was only the beginning to her lucrative legacy. She was one of the founders of the United Negro College Fund. Her civil rights work helped interrogate the Red Cross. She was the only woman of color at the founding conference of the United Nations. Appointed by President Harry S. Truman, she led the U.S. delegation to Liberia for the inauguration of President William V.S. Tubman in 1949. In 1951, she served on President Truman's Committee of 12 for National Defense. She received the honorary doctorate from Rollins College. In 2021, she will become the first African American to represent a state in the National Statuary Hall in the United States Capitol. Her philosophy of education is the basic principle upon which my life has been built. That is the threefold training of head, hand, and heart. She believed in a rounded education with a belief in dignity and retirement of labor, and doing well whatever task is assigned to her. A belief in a spiritual undergirding of all my efforts and a clear, sane mental development. 1 week out of the whole year, all of Mary's children, past and present, come to celebrate the school and its history. The food, the music, the people, and atmosphere is something that connects everyone who obtained an education at the illustrious Bethune-Cookman University. And we call this week Homecoming.
homecoming was, I would say it was more like a family reunion, because you get alumni and current students together and you guys get to see one another and listen to their stories about their time here at Cookman, or what they were involved in within like the campus community. And so that was pretty dope to me.
When I was a student here, that was a long, long, long time ago. My first homecoming was back in 1980. And what I loved about homecoming, it seemed like everybody that came to homecoming, they knew each other. I said, well, do these people live near each other or something? Because everybody seemed like they knew everybody. It seemed like a huge family reunion. We played out at Welch Memorial Stadium, which is where Daytona State is now. And very small stadium. The game would sell out, packed, people standing all around the field. And we had this eternal parade, took forever to march. And 75% of the parade, there was nobody on the streets. And when I think about that, even with all of that, it was a great homecoming. And then to see homecoming where it has evolved to now, where we have a totally different route for parade, and we have a good crowd the entire parade, and it's a much shorter parade. We're playing out at a better stadium with an artificial turf, plenty of parking. Nonetheless, we have a real good turnout. Mostly everybody that wants to come to the game can get into the game. We have a big pep rally on Friday now. With rap artists and all of those things, and step shows and all of those things. So it has evolved into a week of events, per se, more or less than just homecoming weekend. So that shows the growth of Bethune-Cookman University. It was Bethune-Cookman College back then. So, you know, you can look at it a lot of ways. Homecoming has grown just like the university has grown from college to university. So, it's good to see. It's good to experience. It's a little different experience in homecoming as director of bands, because I'm working. You know, all of my classmates and stuff, they had class reunions and all of those things. I can't attend those because we have pep rally that night. After pep rally, I got to get the band back here, dismiss them, try to get a little bit of rest, because we got to be back here at 6 in the morning for the parade. And after the parade, I'll see a few people, but then we got to get ready, dress, uniforms, go out to the stadium. And people see us at the stadium, and don't get me wrong, we have fun. We have a lot of fun, but it's work. I'm on the job, so I don't have the luxury of socializing and sitting with my class and reminiscing as much as I would like to, but it is good to see people, but it's just in a different capacity now than when I was a student.
Skim through a lot of these questions that y'all have. I'm gonna go past them, okay? If you have a question, go through it.
The energy I plan to bring for the band, the energy doesn't really come from me. The energy comes from the students in the band. So far this year, they brought tremendous energy, a lot of creative ideas. And when you have creative ideas and new songs and new maneuvers and new dance steps and new drills and stuff, it creates an energy within the band. So the energy is at a good high right now for the band.
Well,
the world of band at this point, the status of band in this country, especially at black schools, when I say black schools, I don't mean just colleges, I mean high schools and everything, urban schools, band is getting more attention now than it ever has because of social media, Black Lives Matter movement, so anything black has become important now, you know, but so on one side, the future looks extremely bright. The other side, where I have a concern is the actual teaching. We live in a day now where students are used to going to Google and hitting enter and getting an instant answer. Playing an instrument is a skill that's taught over a long period of time. That doesn't happen overnight, you know. So usually a student, before they even get in marching band, they need at least two, preferably 3 years of middle school band. So you're not talking about something that you can do right away. And in this generation coming up now where they can get stuff because of technology right away, a lot of younger students are shying away from band because it takes a lot of time. It's a lot of work. So that concerns me. But the exposure that bands are getting now, especially HBCU bands, is probably at an all-time high because of social media.
Man, that's a deep one. The band has helped me with my own personal pride in ways that my words cannot describe, you know. From showing up here as an 18-year-old kid, you know, and going through freshman year, you know, I was telling myself, man, this is so hard. Marching band is so hard. But even through that process, you know, I developed even new life philosophies, you know. Nothing worth it is gonna ever be easy, you know. And with this program, it's just helped me build my self-confidence, helped me find myself more through the music, in and out of the music, you know. And it's helped me become a better person. It's taught me responsibility, leadership, as we spoke about earlier. And I know when my time is up here, I'll be able to carry these skills for the rest of my life, for sure.
Bethune Grill was originated by my mother, Audrey Hines. My mother basically worked at Volusia Detention Center with all the youth for 25 years. My mom has always been in the culinary field, so she wanted her own restaurant one day. After she retired from the Volusia Detention Center, she started a restaurant, what she always wanted, which is Bethune Grill. It started out, it was established in August 1997. She basically worked for a few years, and she basically designated my brother Shannon Hines as the owner. My siblings, Karen Hankerson and myself, along with my sister Terry Hines and Wayman Davis, we all pitched in to make this business what it is today. We thank God for the college kids, the college young adults, I should say. And basically that's the story, that's our story. We will do anything that we need to do to help the community. You know, we give back all the time, you know, different organizations with the school, you know, they come to us. We may give back in food or, you know, a little monetary donation, you know, and, you know, we help people out with funeral time if they don't have food. We do
turkeys for Thanksgiving. For families, and this year we will be doing a toy drive. It's going to be our first toy drive. So,
it's not the first, yeah.
Yeah, but we're gonna be doing a little toy drive.
Yeah.
To give back to the community.
The biggest lesson I've learned being a black business owner, and the young people don't understand it, but you have to be humble in this business.
And you have to have good customer service skills. You have to bite your tongue a lot because somebody might come in with a negative attitude, and you have to remain humble because you have a business to run. Yeah, and so that I think that has gotten us a long way because we are so humble, and integrity speaks for itself. So they may act, you know, a little ignorant, but we will not stoop to their level. So that is basically the biggest, you know, gripe that I have. And I'm sure that my sister has as well.
That's basically it.
Because we serve everyone, all walks of life.
All walks of life.
Organizations.
Smiley. So what flag you repping?
The Haitian flag. Y'all see me.
Basically, okay.
We gonna make it short and sweet.
Okay, so who y'all think run the yard? Y'all think it's y'all? And today, I was just wondering, what are your thoughts on like this year's homecoming? Like, what are your expectations?
I hope the football team win. One. And I thought it was the service and what it did to the homecoming court. I couldn't believe that. And expectation. I hope it don't rain. Hope it don't rain.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. My name is Tyra Robinson, and I am the director, producer, writer, creator, everything for this documentary. And this little video at the end is to thank you, and I just want to publicly thank you, not just you and the person before you that watched this, not you and the person after you that watched this. I am thanking you because this took a lot of work. This wasn't just a one-day thing and we just did whatever, and you know, we actually dedicated our time, energy, patience, everything to this project. We did it for the love of the art. This was a learning experience, very much so. This is my first documentary. I know this is a very unorthodox way to end a documentary, but what is a better way to give thanks than from the director, you know? So this is straight from the source, and I decided to do that because you guys are important, just as we are as our team and everybody that helped, you know, work on this project. But the viewers are important as well because now you're informed. And being informed is the most important thing that you can really have or do. But that's a whole nother discussion for another time. I had a beautiful team helping me on this project. An all-woman, all-black women team, straight up like that. Just want to say it for the camera right now. An all-black woman team. If that's not amazing, I don't know what it is. And I had this idea randomly one day, just out of nowhere, because this is a school to celebrate. Our founder has done a lot for the African-American community and people in general, and it's just, what a better way to commemorate her legacy than to do a documentary on homecoming. This is the time where everybody comes together and, you know, sings beautifully to Before I Let Go, and, meet people from 1980 something to now, and being able to reconnect, it's like having all your kids in one place. And I wanted to document that because not a lot of people take that into account. We all are a product of this school. We all enter to learn and we all depart to serve. And on that topic, I would love to make a statement here. The students here at Bethune-Cookman University, we are very tenacious, patient, persistent, hardworking overall, and we would just love support from you guys. Everybody that's watching, you, like I said at the beginning, you, we would love support from you. Sometimes as students, we feel underappreciated. We feel like workhorses and, a number. And we are not a number. We are a person. We are a story. We are everything. With that being said, the way I would love for everybody to support us is not by money. We do not want any money. We just want positive affirmations and, resources and guidance and help and all those things, and help in the places that we don't know, and a mentor that we sometimes can't obtain from our limited resources. So I would just love everybody to go down into the comments right now. Go down into the comments. I wanted you to say, "Hail Wildcats, we love you." Because this school is nothing without its students. Point blank, period. Yes, faculty's in charge, and we have this person in charge, and that person, and the dean, and it is, and it. But the students is what makes this school what it is. So I feel like we should all show us some love. We're working hard, and we're going into a future that is very unpredictable and very demanding at the same time. And it could get very stressful. So we would love for you guys to make sure and go right down to the comments and say, "Hail Wildcats, we love you." And I would love to say one more time, thank you. Straight from the source, from me to you. Thank you.